are any general comments or questions from the public, not concerning any particular case that we're going to discuss. If not, we have no meeting minutes this time to approve, so we'll move directly to the first item, a notice of intent for construction of a dock and wooden staircase, work proposed within the riverfront area and land subject to flooding on the Connecticut River. This is 142 Riverbank Road, which we discussed a couple of weeks ago and needed to have a little more deep information before proceeding. I see the applicants on screen. Is your consultant also?
Yeah, there's two. Jeff and
Okay, there you are. Good. So please, all yours.
Doug, are you muted?
Yeah, I can see you, Jeff, but I can't hear you.
Right. No, I was. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
I can hear you, Jeff. Okay.
Doug, I can't hear you.
He's not on mute, so we should be able to hear him.
Can everybody else hear him?
No.
No.
How about now?
Yep, yes.
Yes.
All right, good. Thank you.
There we go.
Excellent. This is also my first time. So new to the Zoom. So this is good. Welcome back. So per your request from our previous hearing, we had revised the narrative and we had revised the site plan and profile to reflect more information related to the construction materials that we'd be using that Lexis and Tyson, the applicants at 142, would use to construct a wooden staircase that would extend down to a seasonal floating dock platform. I'm assuming that everyone has copies of these. Is that
correct? No. I did not receive anything.
Mason, I sent it on Tuesday, so I'm not sure why you weren't able to get that.
Well,
I'll send another one to you right now.
I clicked on that thing on the agenda where it was applications and related documents, and it says it told me that it either sent me to a screen that told me how to shorten my URL.
It was directly attached to that email, but I can send you another one right now.
So it was an attachment, not a link.
Correct.
Okay, well, whatever it was, I didn't get that, or I didn't get any of the DPW stuff that wasn't North Farms Road. I didn't get the Loudville stuff. I did get your comments, though.
Okay. Well, Doug, maybe if you could just go over those,
sure,
those changes. And Mason, I did just send it to you if you're able to look at it.
Well, okay. Absolutely. So that one of the changes that was requested was to add in an additional platform that was previously constructed but needed to be included into this permit. This was a wooden patio structure that was 12 by 14 feet with 168 square feet. So this was added into the narrative and into the site plan for a total of 296 square feet worth of alteration that would take place within the riverfront area. So I won't say anything further regarding that platform. One of the things that we also added in, we put in six native Cornus sericea shrubs, or red osier dogwood shrubs that would be along the top edge of the bank on either side of the stairs going down to offer some amount of enhancement, vegetative enhancement with this. We had previously discussed 2 weeks ago regarding, how that would take place. And one of the suggestions was to not really further disturb the bank. There's a mixture of invasive vegetation and some woody debris along the steep bank, but in order to plant a seed mix, it would require really removing a lot of that woody debris in order to make sure you could get good seed soil contact, and that actually might create far more disturbance than it would benefit. So it seemed like we were discussing to sort of leave the bank as is, but where we could offer some amount of improvement, we did so. So we suggested planting six native shrubs as part of this enhancement. So, all right, I'll continue a little bit further. We further detailed that the stairs would be constructed of pressure treated lumber. So the main spine of the stairs, the would be constructed of like 2x12 lumber and 2x6 stair treads. 2x4 Trex decking for the stairs themselves, and then the how it would be mounted into the ground. One of our, as we were further thinking about this, one of our concerns was the economics of it all and the cost. In looking further into a previous suggestion of micro piles, we were finding places of how to do it, but it was definitely more expensive than installing pressure-treated 4x4 posts, and one could use an auger to dig down 4 feet and then put the posts in and backfill with a stone or gravel mix around each of those posts, and then putting posts in to cover that middle span so that you could do a 16-foot pieces of lumber together, and then with a connector 4x4 post in the middle, kind of holding that together in the middle. So in total, there's there would be 10 posts, five on kind of either side of this structure, from a top landing, the staircase itself, and then a bottom landing. I'm just pausing right now. Questions.
Any questions from commissioners yet?
So the 4x4 posts, would those be installed generally with either hand tools or some handheld auger? No
equipment? They could be done in either method. We did not detail the construction methods because typically we offer the design of what the materials would be and the overall design of something, but not how to go about the means and methods of its construction. So it would be up to the contractor to choose whether they were going to bring in an excavator with a long arm that would have a 6-inch wide auger bit, or a handheld auger down the slope, or using shovels and post diggers to be able to do that. I would imagine renting a handheld auger would be the simplest way to simply walk down the slope with sure footing, and then dig out those areas. That amount of soil that would be disturbed would be less than 1 cubic yard for this. So we think that's minor, and it's our understanding that then under 1 cubic yard by this commission doesn't consider, according to your most recent staff report, doesn't consist of being an actual alteration within the riverbank itself.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions from commissioners?
Another question we had in the previous hearing was on the anchoring system for the dock. And I wonder if any more specific information can come forward on the anchoring system.
Yes, we looked into that further. One of the things that we found that's very common are the use of mushroom anchors for moorings for boats in river and lake conditions, as well as seasonal floating docks. And so rather than large concrete blocks that would be difficult to remove on an annual basis, on a seasonal basis, we're suggesting 30-pound mushroom anchors that'd be attached to chains at the base of the floating platform, and then they'd be able to be lifted out. But a 30-pound anchor was recommended as a size large enough for a 30-plus-foot motorboat, as a mooring in river and lake conditions. So we thought that this was ample enough for this floating platform, which I imagine is far less weight than a boat or a craft of that size. So
in the revised drawings, there were dual anchors, weren't there? I don't have it on screen in front of me, but.
That's correct. There are two different anchors, one kind of at the up slope and then lower slope, so that basically both sides would be done with this. And typically they're done in a crisscross fashion. So I'm kind of holding my hands up to the screen, but they're done as an X fashion so as to provide the most stability.
Four anchors total?
Four anchors total, one on each corner. That's all correct.
Right. Any other questions? Seems like the, want to confirm, we discussed last time, in the winter, the dock is not going to be dragged up the slope. It's going to be taken out elsewhere on the river on some kind of trailer or something?
We discussed that several weeks ago. Alexis and Tyson, please... chime in. I think it does vary depending on the actual weight of the platform. They haven't chosen a platform as far as we understand. So if that is some folks do pull it up onto the nearby embankment, and I think their plan is to remove it in the winter time to not leave it there over winter. But if it's too heavy to lift up and carry up the staircase, then they'd want to figure out a way to bring it, trailer it across. Tow it across the river itself and then pull it out on some sort of a trailer. But oftentimes these are light enough that people can carry them out.
But carry them, actually just lifted it up and carry it up the stairs rather mm-hmm. than drag it up the bank. That was my concern, was disturbing the bank by...
We would not drag it up the bank. We would either have to have something light enough that could be carried without, you know, touching the bank, or if it weren't light enough, then we would utilize Sportsman's Marina to pull it out with a trailer.
Okay. Any other questions from commissioners? Any questions or comments from anyone else, any member of the public?
If I could just add, you know, like, I just want to state, and I have had, you know, some conversations with Sarah about, you know, what we can do and what we can't do out here. I mean, we're homeowners here. We're very invested in this property. The last thing that we want to do is compromise any amount of integrity of our riverbank or our property at all. So I just want that to be known. We definitely don't want our house falling into the river or anything like that.
I understand. Thank you. Okay. Motion to close.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Jack, do you have not video capability, or is your video turned off?
No, you can't see me?
Can't see you. I can hear you.
Oh, I can hear you, but I can't. I can hear you and see you, but I guess you're not seeing me.
There's probably a dialogue box somewhere if you... move a cursor over parts of the screen where you can toggle on and off the video. But in the meantime, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We have closed the hearing. And so for commissioners, what do you think? It seemed like our concerns were not that this was a realistically worrisome or damaging project, but just we wanted to get all the details that we would normally require in the plan. I think Sarah also added in her staff report that we want to make sure that whatever those plantings are that go on either side, that and I can appreciate the fact that cleaning up invasives, which we had previously talked about, might actually do more harm than good.
Yeah.
So the native plantings that do go in would have to be checked over our usual three-season period before a certificate of compliance would be issued and replanted if they happen to have died. Any other additional conditions that any of the commissioners think we ought to add?
I have not seen the upgraded plan, but I take it that it has all those concerns addressed on it.
Yeah, there's a lot more detail than first first version. Sarah, do you have any other conditions you want to recommend?
No, I don't think so. I agree with the applicant's assessment that trying to do any additional plantings on the bank might destabilize it further and cause more harm than good. I think the dogwoods are a good choice.
Okay, so does someone want to make a motion to grant an order of conditions, including standard conditions plus the additional review of plantings after 3 years?
I'll make the motion.
Jason, second, anyone?
Seconded.
And further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? So voted. All right, thank you. Good luck with that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Stay healthy.
Thank you. Yep. Stay well. Hang in there. Thank you.
Next item, we are just past 5:45, so we can do notice of intent for paving and roadway drainage improvements. Work to take place in the bank and riverfront area and bordering land subject to flooding. This on Meadow Street and Loudville Road, rights of way. Who's speaking to that?
Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
This is Johanna Stacy.
Can hear you and see you.
Oh, okay. My screen keeps going in and out here, so. I'm the senior planner with the Department of Public Works. David Valletta, the city engineer, is also online, as are Don Nims and Chris Baker, who are engineers with DPW as well. So to start off, why don't I provide a brief overview of both projects. They're two separate paving projects, one on Meadow Street in Florence. It starts at Spring Street and planning to repave all the way to the parking lot of Lilly Library. Much of the project areas within bordering land subject to flooding. And there's also riverfront area associated with the Mill River within the project area. The Mill River is a cold water fishery. And also associated with the Mill River is priority habitat and estimated habitat for rare species. The proposed work appears to be exempt for priority habitat under MESA. And the copy of the application was sent to Natural Heritage for work within estimated habitat. So why don't I talk about Meadow Street first, and then I'll talk about work on Loudville Road.
Okay.
Most of the work that's proposed is either authorized under the General Order of Conditions from the DPW or through the Northampton City Wetlands Ordinance. There are a few parts of the project that are not, and that includes adding 9 paved parking spaces adjacent to the roadway near the Grow Food Northampton property. Currently, there's a lot of folks who park off the road in this area. so there's bare soil, it gets muddy in storms, and it also compromises the pavement that way. So
I was out there today on a bike ride, and it's very crumbling and decayed all along that whole section.
Yeah, exactly. So the paved parking spaces hopefully will address that. We're also proposing dense grade fresh stone shoulders in areas along the roadway, again, to prevent erosion from bare soil, and also to help improve the integrity of the pavement. So there's a hard shoulder there. because we are proposing to pave within boring land subject to flooding, we're proposing to create an infiltration trench that's 2 feet wide and 100 feet long. And this more than attenuates the runoff from the increased paved area. We're not proposing to decrease flood storage capacity within the floodplain. We are attenuating the increased impervious area within the floodplain. So we think there should be an overall improvement to in terms of stormwater and site conditions. Should I pause there for questions about Meadow Street?
Yes. One question I had is, there's when you get near the river, there's a hard granite curb. Is this work going to change any of that, or is this going to just replace the area where right now it goes from pavement to crumbly pavement to a grassy, muddy area?
I don't believe we are proposing to add any curbing if there isn't already curbing there. We are replacing some curbing that's crumbling in poor condition.
The part near the river, I think, was done fairly recently. I'm trying to remember when, but within memory. And it's a, I forget what you call that kind of granite, right angle, hard edged curb, but all leading up to and across the river. That's the what the edge of the road there looks like. And I just was...
That granite curbing was installed as part of the Florence Fields project that done through planning. So they extended sidewalk up that length and put some vegetation, some trees along there and some granite benches. And made connectivity with the bike path along Florence Fields and then crossing over Meadow Street a little bit further up at a pedestrian crosswalk and then moving that sidewalk over to the other side. And the only way to fit that in was to bring that sidewalk right up against the granite curbing.
Okay. But that the granite curbing is not going to be changed by this project?
I don't believe so, no.
Okay. Other questions about Meadow Street from commissioners?
What sort of treatment and maintenance is proposed for the swale that's being created? That wasn't really addressed in the application.
The infiltration trench?
Yeah.
I don't think we're proposing a swale there.
Oh, so the trench, sorry.
The trench itself?
In the screens.
David, do you want to take that question?
I just want to take a quick look at the plan set there and see if I can. Basically, there's a pea stone and gravel detail at the surface there. So, you know, theoretically, that would need to be maintained after a few years if vegetation started to grow in there. But that would have to, you know, we would certainly do that if that was required. But it should hold up, you know, the granular material, stone material over the entire width of the trench. That should maintain itself pretty well.
Did everybody hear that?
Yeah.
Hear it well enough? Yeah.
Do I need a little more volume?
Well, I think there was just some other disturbing sounds that were causing mics to cut in and out. So. Okay, anybody have any other questions about Meadow Street?
Nope, none.
You want to talk about Loudville, Joanna?
Okay. Again, on Loudville, we're proposing to repave the portions of Loudville Road that are within Northampton. Not quite up to the intersection with Route 66, but fairly close. So much of Loudville Road is proximate to the Manhattan River, which is a cold water fishery. And as such, there are portions of bordering land subject to flooding and riverfront area within the project area. Again, much of the work is exempt or authorized under the general order of conditions for the Northampton Wetlands Ordinance. There are a few areas that are not. And those areas that are part of this application include creating a vegetated swale that's seen on sheet C4 that will drain to an existing catch basin. There's some repair work to an inlet, also on sheet C4, to prevent that from crumbling and material entering the drain pipe. There's repair work proposed for the head wall to a culvert that carries a perennial stream to the Manhattan. The repair work is covered under the general order of conditions. We're proposing to add a small amount of stone to the head, to the base of the head wall, to prevent further erosion from the stream, from the river. And lastly, we're adding crushed stone shoulders to portions of the road, again, to help shore up the pavement and to prevent erosion from bare soil along the edge of the pavement. We're not proposing any alteration of floor storage capacity. And the proposed stormwater improvement should improve the water quality of runoff from this area.
Questions from commissioners? In both of these cases,
Johanna, DEP had noticed that the there's a slope failure shown. On, let's see what page. There's no page number, but it's the culvert outlet head wall near House 85. Is there any work proposed to address the erosion in that spot?
There, we haven't proposed to address that. I don't know. I haven't checked to see if that area is within the right of way or not.
Okay. So it may not even be possible to address that as part of this project.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I saw the comments later this afternoon, but I haven't had a chance to look at it.
Okay, I can't even find Loudville Road.
You know where that is, right, Mason?
No.
Oh, if you're heading out 66, I mean, you're not in West Hampton yet, but you take a left.
It's that far out.
It's okay. Pretty out, yeah.
All right.
Yeah, past Ridgeview Road.
Okay. I don't have a set of plans in front of me, so I don't know.
The very southwest corner of town.
Right.
Must be some way we can hold plans up some in future hearings.
Well, there is a way that anybody can show what's on their computer and they can put it up full screen for everybody to see. I'm a little reluctant to try it because I have never done it myself, but I've seen it happen with other Zoom calls that I've been on. So we'll probably get good at this after.
Yeah. And I've seen it done with office software or something, or some other type of business software where they can zoom in on the plan with arrows and so on.
Sarah's doing something, screen sharing coming up.
Yeah, she's screen. Yep.
Yeah. So this is the, these are the photo sections. So this is Meadow Street.
It's not slow internet.
So this is the location of the infiltration trench from the previous.
Can anybody else see what Sarah's showing?
Nope.
No.
We have a black screen, Sarah, that says Sarah Lavallee has started screen sharing, but there isn't anything showing. And then we're all back.
All right. Randy, that seems to exceed my bandwidth. If anybody else wants to hit the share screen button, it's pretty easy to do.
Yeah, Sarah, did you say that there was a problem with one of the natural heritage areas that you said did require?
Yeah, so this should qualify to be fully exempt, but since we haven't heard back from natural heritage and there isn't the clear exemption for the priority versus the estimated, we technically shouldn't close the hearing. David and Johanna, what's your bid schedule given the pandemic? Are you still looking to go out to bid with this as soon as possible?
I think we are. David, you can probably answer that more specifically.
Okay. We obviously would like to go out to bid as soon as we can, but we don't really know what's going on in terms of the bidding environment. The governor has just issued some directives regarding construction, which are a little bit in conflict with DPW's current approach, and we're trying to get that resolved. Nonetheless, we're trying to move projects forward. Obviously, we don't want to go out to bid until this permit has been approved.
Randy, thanks for putting those up. It was it's hard to look at the detail, Mason. I found and I said this to Sarah, that when I tried to expand it, the little details got so fuzzy that it was difficult to read. So,
no, I appreciate that. At least I know where I am, and I've been to that site many times before. But the old bridge was there.
Right. So, any other questions from commissioners? Any comments or questions from anyone else? If not, motion to close the hearing.
I thought we were going to wait for NH.
That's the next case, right?
I think there's a couple different ways to deal with it. I don't expect any comments from Natural Heritage. DEP's comments were things that can be addressed in the final construction plan set, and this work does appear to be clearly exempt. If you wanted to close the hearing and then have me hold off on issuing the order until Natural Heritage gets back to us, I don't know when that would be, given their office staffing situation. That would be an option as well.
I'd feel comfortable with that, yeah.
Yeah, I agree. That's a good approach.
So yes to close and issue an order, but one of the conditions being Sarah must affirm the receipt of the DEP or is that Natural Heritage? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. So you want to do it that way? So we would need a motion to close.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
So with that added condition, in addition to standard conditions, anything else that commissioners want to recommend that we should add as part of the order of conditions?
No.
If not, someone want to make a motion to
move the conditions?
Grant an order of conditions with the standard conditions plus that additional condition that Sarah will affirm the receipt of the pending report. The motion.
Yes.
Have a second.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
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 Opposed? So voted. All right. Sarah, how are we going to do the signatures on these things?
So the last item on the agenda is to authorize me to sign on behalf of the
committee. I see. Okay.
Seemed like the cleanest way to do it.
That's what that agenda item meant. Okay. Thank you.
Why is it not on checks?
Definitely not.
Last item, the notice of intent for replacement of existing stormwater pipe, abandonment of existing point source stormwater discharge to Broadbrook, creation of new stormwater discharge and pedestrian path culvert replacement. This all at North Farms at Broadbrook and Fitzgerald Lake area. And who's going to be speaking to that?
Okay, I'll be speaking also to that.
Okay.
As well.
Sorry, excuse me, Joanne, I just need to interrupt you. So Kevin, I'm going to recuse myself from this item because I'm a neighbor to this project, but I'll sit in.
Okay, thank you, Elizabeth.
Sure. Sorry, Johanna.
Okay, that's okay. So again, the DPW is proposing a repaving project that begins at North Maple Street and continues through all of North Farms Road up to the Williamsburg town line. Within that whole stretch, there are two areas where we're proposing to work within wetland resource areas. One is the replacement of a drain line that runs beneath the road and through the property of Robert Bollinger. And discharges towards a wetland area. We're proposing, and I'll talk about the drain outfall separately. Mm-hmm. For that project, we're proposing to, there's isolated vegetated wetland at the inlet of the crossing, which is that sort of the base of the slope. So, drainage from the hillside kind of collects at the bottom of the slope before it passes through this drain pipe. The outlet of the drain is situated right at the boundary of bordering vegetative wetland. And there is a scour pool right beyond the outlet of the pipe. Currently, the pipe only passes 6 cubic feet per second. Flow from a 2-year, 24-hour storm is significantly higher than that. So water tends to pool. It tends to start discharging to the roadway. So we're planning to install a larger pipe, a 24-inch pipe, so that this doesn't happen in the future. The basic layout of the pipe would be very similar to where it is now. We're proposing a stone around the inlet to reduce the amount of sedimentation that happens into the pipe. And we're proposing stone at the outlet also to reduce erosion at that location as well. So that's the project overview for that section.
Anybody have any questions about that part before we start talking about the outfall area that might have to get pulled back?
Hi, I don't know if you can hear me. I'm Robert Bollinger. I'm the one that the pipe is going through. I don't know at what point I should chime in on this. If I should come in now, or when would my...
Sure, why don't you tell us your thoughts.
Okay, so I am the landowner that the pipe currently goes through, and the city does not have an easement. They never had an easement way back in the day when, you know, things were done with a simple handshake. So they did go and design all this without before coming to me and talking about it, which I wish they would have. But that's, you know, moved on. So my concerns about this is making sure that, you know, I have a proper easement, you know, set up before they set foot on my property with an agreement. The other thing is that I'm concerned about the water that's discharging from this pipe already discharges out, and it's done this for years because it's never properly been maintained at the end of the discharge location, that it comes onto flatland and it keeps getting wetter on a higher section of my field where so much water comes into that flatland, it backs up where other water is coming. So my field is getting wetter due to that. And the neighbor next door, Jamie Golak, his property that I haven't hayed in probably 5 or 6 years because of the storm water, and well, so much because it's gotten so wet. Our proposal, what we're trying to have done, is some type of a swale from that discharge pipe so that the water will continue to have somewhere to go, not just onto a flat surface. I mean, again, it's pretty frustrating to be dealing with this, knowing that both of us being landowners pay us Northampton City stormwater sewer tax for this, and accept the stormwater onto our properties, and our properties are getting wetter due to this. And that's the most frustrating part of it all.
Well, my understanding is that part of the purpose of this project is to ensure that there are adequate volume in the piping and such, that there's adequate volume so that the buildup won't happen anymore, that's the purpose. Am I understanding that right? That this, if this were to be done as designed, that flooding both on the road and in the field wouldn't happen anymore?
No, where the water is being discharged at the current location. When you discharge the water that comes out there onto a flat surface and it doesn't have a swale or anywhere to go, that amount of water is just going to start to pool and go every direction it can. If it doesn't have a slope or a swale to go into, it's not going to go anywhere. It's just going to stay on that flat surface and expand that over surface. That's why we're looking to get a swale across there.
Okay, so the screen's just changed here. Try to get back to the other layout. Can someone from the DPW address that question about two things, I guess. About whether it's possible, without an agreement. So, what your understanding is about that, and whether the discharge. Mr. Bonner is describing is
somebody sharing
a somebody screen. Sharing a screen.
Could you whoever sees it, whoever sees it, plus press on that.
Yeah, the audio is
Who's sharing the screen? There we go.
That seems better.
I'm not sure who was doing that.
Sorry, that was me. I was trying to get the video up.
Oh, you were trying to join. I see. So, if someone from DPW want to speak to those two issues about one, the right of way and or easement, and the other about the flat space for discharge that would still be at risk of flooding.
So
can I say something, James? Excuse me. This is James Golick. I'm the I'm neighbors with Bobby, and the water ultimately ends up on my property after this discharge. And I talked to Sarah earlier today. What happens is it just over the years, with the, it's been in a wooded area, and it's filled in with like sticks and leaves and everything. And now it's just dammed up, and it just comes south, and it ends up in my back field. I can't even mow my back field. In my opinion, it should be even extended another 20 feet before you put the swale at this point. Because right now, the back corner of my field, we can't even mow anymore the way it's set up right now. It just comes in and dives in right into my property. It doesn't even go make it to the wetland. It actually makes it right to the back of my field. So it's the, and it runs all the time. It's not just when it rains. It's running even on, in the summer with groundwater. It's, it runs all the time. It's not like it shuts off just because it stops raining. Like, it's running full right now. So it's continuously running and saturating my backfield.
So is it safe to assume that if the pipe is replaced with just a larger diameter pipe but nothing else changes, that it would make the current condition even worse?
I don't know if it'll make it worse, because the biggest problem we have now is with it being a smaller pipe that it clogs up and it backfills and erodes the road. The discharge isn't the problem with what you're having at the roadside. It's just telling you what's happening when it's discharging, where, how it's accumulating and coming into the backside of my property. So that swale, or however you want to do it to determine, direct it away from the back of my property, that will be very important. And that would help Bobby back to getting back to hay in the back and helping me maintain the back of my field, which has been done for years.
And that would also help me on my fields, also on a higher part in my fields where so much water is coming into that area and into that flat surface and backing up over a period of time. Because I have another low spot in my field where the water comes off of all the high spots down through that used to actually drain into that area. But when you have so much water and wetness in there, that ground can only soak up so much. And it's not soaking
up. My screen is freezing up. I don't know if anybody else is having that problem.
No, just you. We can still hear you though.
Yep.
Okay. So did anybody hear the last things that I said
about
yes.
not soaking up all the groundwater?
Yep.
Yep.
Right, because that, like I said, once that you put so much more water from that street over the years and not maintain that discharge, that flat surface doesn't dry, doesn't drain, and it just keeps encroaching and coming back further and further. And the lower part of my field, which is next to that, you know, up further from that discharge, but a lower part of the field next to that swamp area, when that swamp doesn't get a chance to dry out due to all that water being put into it, the rest of my field continues to get wetter and wetter, as that, if that discharge is not maintained and pushed out, I'm going to lose more field every year, like I've been doing. That's why we're trying to get some type of a swale so that this water, when it leaves that pipe, will flow to almost like a brook in the back area of the property, where it eventually, that's where it all ends up anyways, after saturating and going through this flat surface anyways, it eventually reaches that brook in the back. It seems like it would just make logical sense to have some type of a swale to reach that point so that the water would stop wetting, you know, property that we own, that we're losing property all the time and still paying a stormwater runoff tax and on taxes on our property that we're losing to try to have crop on.
Can somebody from the DPW speak to that? I've been out there many times, but I haven't been recently looking at exactly this issue.
How far away is the resource area from the end of the pipe?
The bordering,
it's right at the resource area as currently proposed.
The end of the pipe is about the same location as the edge of the wetland.
Okay, I was just looking at the construction plans here. I don't see the resource area.
Sorry to chime back in again, but I was told before in a meeting that I had, and it was under speculation that, but if you keep dumping so much water into an area and it discharges out of that pipe at a high speed of rate and hits the ground, it's going to create that cesspool, which they're talking about. Then that's going to take that sediment and push it down and not have that the swale that it should have, and just let that water go wherever it wants. And it's continued to getting worse. That's why I can't emphasize enough, if it was maintained properly, and I do understand that was there was never a proper easement in place to do this. So over a period of time, I wish I could have got a hold of some old timers that had been around forever and ever and watched that swamp grow due to this amount of stuff that's been going on. But, you know, it's hard to do something like that.
Yeah, I mean, one comment about that is, if you step back and look at the larger landscape around this area and around that, there's a pretty significant wetland area that exists to the east of Mr. Bollinger's property. And that is basically the bottom of a bowl. So all of the topography around it is higher. So it's sort of the entire hillside around it is draining into that larger wetland area.
And all of that is draining into my lower bowl area, which you just said. And in that lower bowl area, if the swale was created, which, you know, at the time, maybe when that pipe was put in way back years ago, I don't remember, I'm not sure. There may have been a swale there. And if when that pipe was put in back years ago, they did what you guys are trying to do right now, put stone at the end of it so it wouldn't create that cesspool like you're talking about. I don't, and again, this is speculation. I don't think this would have been as bad as it was. And I, in my opinion, again, it's my opinion of speculation that if there was a swale drawn out there and bringing the water to its location where it ends up anyways, our properties would not continue to get wetter over the years as we go on, because I understand as times change, we're getting more rainwater and everything, and I understand that the ground has been getting wetter. I understand that. But when you still keep taking the amount of water and dumping it into one location and not giving it an area to discharge from, and if it's not maintained out there at all, then every year when the leaves and the sticks fall and create more compost and material, that is going to rise up, and it's going to keep backing up more and more on our property every year. The more
let me ask an operational question of the DPW. If you are currently without a formal easement to do the work, can you do the work? I mean, as I say, without knowing exactly where the lines are, I don't know whether what you're proposing is doable without an easement.
It's our preference to wait until the construction is complete. We've made a promise to Mr. Bollinger that we would execute an easement with him, but it makes more sense once we know the exact pipe alignment to be able to draw an easement from what's been constructed rather than to execute an easement in advance.
In this case, there's an existing pipe. Why can't you use, and it appears that you're putting a new one in very close to the existing pipe. I would think it would be fairly easy to get your 20-foot wide drain easement with the existing pipe.
We could do that, but if we use the existing pipe, it won't have the same alignment as the proposed pipe. And so then that easement will be offset from where the proposed pipe is. So,
no, I see.
There's basically, you know, there's a plan on a piece of paper, but what actually happens on the ground will be a little.
Yeah.
And so it would not be impossible to get an easement in advance. We could do that, but it would be our preference to do it after the work is constructed, with all due promises that we would execute that. There are certainly other situations within the city historically where there's city infrastructure across private property that doesn't have easements. And we've been doing our best as we come across those to try to rectify those situations.
I understand.
But I understand.
Sorry to chime in again on this, but so my problem was last fall, I wanted to be part of this so that, you know, we could have talked about this construction process. So that knowing that there already was a pipe there, knowing that my wetlands were being, you know, further out. And I was told before, having an ag, I would probably be exempt to this, you know, because in putting a swale out there. That's why I was a little frustrated why I wasn't brought into this process, because it's dumping onto my property. And I chimed in earlier to make sure that I could try to be part of this. And if we had set, you know, and talked about this more, we could have just got the easement and not been in this time of crisis with everybody on a computer screen and be able to walk out to the site and see what we're all talking about and had this set hashed out even before we had a design drawn, because we would have been able to see everything that was out there and talk with Jamie Golak, the neighbor, and really discuss this before we're on a crunch time. We're trying to get this out to a bid process and everything.
So I do want to make the commission aware that we have been in touch with Mr. Vollinger and we have discussed the project with him, and we've done everything we can to try to accommodate and recognize that he's got an agricultural operation out there. The intention with the project is to actually do most of the project during the regular construction season, and then he's indicated to us what would be his preferred window so as not to disturb his operations, so that we could put the pipe in the late fall after harvest is complete. So we have been working with Mr. Vollinger to try to work things out as best we can. We feel a little bit stymied by the fact that the end of the pipe is right up against the resource area. We don't feel like we have any way that we can try to provide any kind of further accommodation out into that resource area.
So again, my concern is...
Excuse me, I want to ask Sarah a question. As staff, and having been out there, because this sounds to me like it could be that the city needs an easement and the landowner wants there to be certain conditions met in order to grant such an easement. I am not able to visualize the whole situation to understand what it would take to address the landowner's concerns and accomplish the goals that the DPW is trying. So I'm looking to Sarah, who has been out there more recently, to try and illuminate what are the trade-offs here? What are we wrestling with? That, from your perspective, is there a way to accomplish both parts of this, to get an easement that's agreeable to the owner and still accomplish what the city needs to have happen?
Sure. So I think there's a lot of factors at play and a lot of different things going on. DPW has presented this as a limited project, which it most certainly qualifies for. But they're still not able to place the outfall within the resource area itself, so that Mr. Vollinger's preference for having a longer pipe is infeasible. But as an agricultural landowner with land in active operation, he would have options down the road for dealing with the flow if it does present a concern moving forward. But it may be helpful if DPW could talk about flows that they're looking at and how this situation might actually be a little bit improved from the current situation.
So it gets a little complex. So the current pipe is smaller, so the flows are limited, and presumably the water is flowing faster when it comes through the pipe. That's presumably, that isn't based on actual observations. So if we're proposing to replace a 12-inch pipe with a 24-inch pipe, there would be additional capacity. but yeah, I mean, it's to, I think what Sarah's getting at maybe is volume comparisons, which are hard to do because they're going to be based on the storm event. And each storm event is going to be different.
I can see this is curing your backup problem, but not really doing anything for the outlet problem.
Yeah, again, not to chime back in, but I don't think it matters whether it's a 12-inch pipe, a 24-inch pipe, a 6-inch pipe. The amount of water that you're dumping at the end of the property, whether it comes out all at once or a period of 3 days, is still going to saturate the end of the property. And if there is not a swale for it to flow out, when the property, the ground, flat ground gets saturated, it's going to just keep backing up to the drier area around it. If you have a swale, it's going to flow. It doesn't matter whether it's a 12-inch pipe, a 24-inch pipe, the same amount of water is going to come through that, whether it be in 6 hours or 6 days. It's still going to dump into that flat surface that is saturated. And if that saturated ground has nowhere to flow, it's going to just expand out further onto the dry land that's going to suck up the water.
Well, unfortunately, it's the suggestion is putting a swale that's in an existing wetland, which
we can't allow.
Makes it more difficult as far as permitting. And the other solution is to pull the pipe back, but then you're creating a swale in the middle of a hayfield, and that's no solution for the farmer.
Yeah, if you pull the pipe back, it's going to come back to the side of my field. I'll lose more field, and you're still not fixing the problem of what happened in the beginning of why the sides of the fields are damming up and why everything's getting so wet. I can't emphasize enough, when you have an area that's flat and sticks and leaves and everything falls down and fills in areas, you know, who knows back in the day if there was a swale when they put that in. But that's the thing, it hasn't, you know.
Yeah.
I think one thing to consider is that we're not proposing a larger volume of water.
No, I understand.
That's being discharged. It's just being more focused through the pipe. I mean, when the pipe backs up right now, the road overflows and it flows across the field. So all that water is eventually getting to the same location. We're proposing that it be done in a more controlled fashion, which would be out of the new pipe.
I understand that, and there is still the problem of the previous problem of the water making my field wetter all the time. And the main problem is, the most frustrating thing, I'm going to repeat myself again, is that we pay a stormwater tax for this. I'm on the Northampton Ag Commission, and when it's brought up about this, we bring this up, and Wayne Fiden wants to drop it, because I thought we were supposed to be helping the farmers and working with the farmers, because we have a right to farm community in Northampton. That's what I was always involved in. But I understand it's wetlands and all of this. It's just, it's a very frustrating when the farmers are still charged for a water runoff tax and they're accepting water runoff and they're losing property on top of it.
Sarah, you had mentioned a few minutes ago that as an agricultural use, that there at a future time, there are options that the landowner might have available. Can you say, I'm wondering if there's a way in which we can understand what those options might be and build them into this process so that the landowner has some assurance that the city's need and the landowner's need can be addressed.
Sure. I mean, anything that that Mr. Vollinger would be thinking about would be down the road and not part of this project. But there are a lot of agricultural exemptions within the Wetlands Protection Act for maintenance of field edges and drainage ditches and those types of things that may be able to be undertaken and have a positive impact on how saturated the field is. And David, maybe you could speak to how the presence of an easement down the road would create some affirmative maintenance responsibility for DPW. And I know since there isn't an easement now, if a property owner were to call and say, you know, there's a scour pool, there's some other issues, would DPW be able to address that? That probably wouldn't be likely, but would that change in the situations being proposed?
The proposed easement there would include repair and maintenance and replacement of the pipe that's being proposed. So maintenance would include ensuring that the pipe remains free and clear and doesn't get clogged up. Obviously, if it's a larger pipe as we're proposing with a 24-inch, we don't believe that that's going to be a problem in terms of the pipe clogging up. The scour pool, not the scour pool, but the discharge area would also be able to be maintained within the limits of that easement. Obviously, the easement would have to, couldn't go into the wetland area. We wouldn't be able to do any work within the wetland area to do any maintenance. That's why we're trying to, and that's why the proposal is obviously keeping that riprap discharge area outside of the wetland area.
Let me go back to my operational question. If the landowner does not let you onto his land, can you do this project?
I don't believe so.
So we're at a kind of dilemma about landowner has certain wishes and wants those wishes addressed before giving permission to do the work. At least that's my understanding.
But my understanding is that the landowner also already has an existing issue that he wants to have resolved. And if we don't do the work, then I don't know how that issue gets resolved.
Right.
I'm trying
to have a sense of what would have to be included in order for both parties to feel like, oh, okay, good. This is working the way the city needs it to, and it's working the way the landowner needs it to in order to give permission to the city to do the work. I'm just trying to understand where the balance might be possible.
Hi, this is James Golick again, stepping in. With Bobby, I know it's hard because we can't go out there and take a look at it. If you could just, without going right into the wetlands, if you could understand and see what that piece of property is like out there, before you actually go right in and you see you can't work into the wetlands, where it's discharging now, you could very easily extend it 15 feet. That's all it would take. And then from there on, we could actually do a swale over under agricultural to make it any other adjustments after the project was done. If you extended that a little bit, that would help Bobby protect his field from being keep getting wetter and keep his edges. And then if you only added just that little bit to that piece of pipe going out to where it drops from now, that would save my property in the back corner immensely. And I think it would help Bobby a lot and that's all it would really take, 15, 20 feet tops. And it's just a piece of pipe, one piece added to that. And then I think you'd have a green light on that. I think it would help out a lot. And you wouldn't be actually digging in the wetlands at all. It's all exposed. And if you're going in at the same elevation where the discharge is now, it's up right now. You could actually just extend it out just a little bit. We're not talking about going miles or 20, 30, 40, 50 feet. We're just talking 15 or 20 feet of an extension would help immensely in that case.
Sarah, would such an extension push into a protected zone?
Yeah.
Yeah, and any extension of what's already shown on the plans would be directly within the BBW and wouldn't be allowed under the Wetlands Protection Act.
Yeah.
Because it's only wetlands right where it is, because that's where it's diving in and flows all the time. If that didn't dive in and flow all the time, that corner would dry right up. It used to be dry.
That's why that where that pipe discharges has become wet, because of that pipe
yes.
discharges and created that whatever you want to call it, cesspool or whatever, and leaves the water in that area because it was never maintained and let the water flow out properly.
That's causing that to become a wetland. You've made that wetlands with the way that's piped at this point.
And again, so the frustrating part is if being ag exempt, even again, so being ag exempt, if me, the farmer, is entitled to go out into the swamp or the wetland area and create this drainage to help dry out my property at this, I mean, what, how much time and cost is this going to take me that I'm doing to help dry out my property from an issue from the city that I'm already paying a stormwater runoff tax for, that it's going to cost me more money to go out onto my own property to dig a swale and maintain that swale because the city's not going to do it because it's in a wetland and they're telling me that they can't go out there. So that's another frustrating part to this whole thing, is it's costing me more money and more work.
There, we are constrained by the Wetlands Act and the Wetlands Ordinance, and so there are certain things that we can allow and certain things that we cannot. So I understand that there are some things that are by nature frustrating, given the regulatory constraints that we all have to live with. I'm not seeing right now how to go forward with this. Short of...
Sorry to interrupt, but the last thing I want to do is hold up a project because I am on the street. The street needs to get fixed. I do not want to hold the project up. If there was some way that we could make sure that there was going to be an easement, you know, that we could come up with an agreement for an easement to make this happen somehow, and that there was somehow to make sure that we'd be able to get some type of a swale through that swamp at a later date, it's just frustrating. Then we could move on.
Issues.
David?
I believe those are two different issues. We had made a good faith promise to Mr. Bollinger that an easement will be forthcoming in conjunction with the project if that portion of the project moves ahead. We can continue to do the project and not make a change here. That is entirely possible that we will continue and do the rest of North Farms Road, and if we can't make this change, then it will not be part of the project, but it doesn't scuttle the project altogether. So as I said, we've made a good faith easement, commitment to Mr. Bollinger to establish an easement to install, repair, and maintain this pipe and the outfall. On the flip side, we're getting some pushback from DEP that we shouldn't actually even be having the outfall where it is and that it should be shortened. So,
I saw those comments.
We have conflicting issues here. From the DPW point of view, just taking comments into account, we don't think it's a good idea to pull the pipe any further back from the edge of the wetland because the end of the pipe right now, as has been noted, has a bit of a scour pool to it. And if we pull it back, we're concerned if that scour pool is not addressed by some sort of riprap outlet, then any riprap further upstream from that is not going to be stable and is eventually going to get undermined and will be a long-term maintenance issue for the DPW and will create further instability at the end of the pipe.
Well, other commissioners, what do you think? I'm sort of stuck here. I'm not sure what our options are.
Perhaps a site visit.
Yeah, got to get out there and see the details. And I'm not sure that then that'll magically reveal any great insight that'll allow a clear solution. But at this point, it's hard for me to see how close the hearing and move forward.
Kevin, I think Wallinger and the DPW some kind of consensus. I wouldn't want to approve a project that is not accurate at the end. Why to make everybody happy. That would seem most efficient, in my opinion, to let them work it out and then come back to us with the petition.
This is just part of the project. I mean, I think the rest.
You got a big road, and this is one little piece.
Yeah, gotcha.
Yeah, we have often been in the position to remind ourselves as a commission not to try and re-engineer anybody else's project, but to let the applicant come back to us with alternatives and revisions. And right now, it seems like we're at a bit of an impasse. And so unless I'm missing something, it seems like we have to turn it back to the applicant and the landowner whose land is involved to say, we got to come up with, we're happy to agree to whatever you guys can agree to as long as it doesn't violate the either the ordinance or the act that we have to live with it. And so already, and this is also part of this discussion, the outfall currently is in a wetland in an area that we shouldn't be permitting work to be done. And yet DPW here, that if you pull it back, you think it's gonna make things worse and not accomplish the distribution that you think is needed in order for this to be successful. So I turn to my other commissioners and see if I'm missing anything, but it seems like the posture for the commission at this point is that we can't see a clear solution.
So if I could speak for 1 minute, sorry. So obviously there is an existing pipe right there with no proper easement. So the first, in my opinion, yes, the first solution is to address the easement. And yes, the second issue would be separate from this whole construction, because whether they change the pipe or not, there's still going to be water that's dumping into that that's causing me a problem. So like I said before, I have no problem whether they leave that pipe there or put in a new one, the same amount, I'm still going to have the same problem that's there. So if we can acquire and come up to an agreement for an easement, that would be fine. And if we can address another hearing about this for an ag exempt to do a swale, but it's rather going to be frustrating for me to keep this process going, knowing that it's going to cost me more money if I do get permission to go dig that swale and do it, and more time. I was hoping to have this resolved in one meeting and be done.
Well, and Bob, the process for that would be that you would have to propose some sort of solution that would work for you. I mean, you wouldn't be able to dig into the DBW, but you would potentially be able to maybe maintain other field edges or address some drainage that you have in other parts of your farm that might be able to address that. But we're only dealing with the DPW application that's been presented at this point.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So if this is one, like two parts, so if I have to go back to another meeting and bring this up and you know, have a site visit regarding this and see what we can address, that's what, you know, probably the best way that we can resolve it right now. Because like I said, no matter what, whether this pipe and the new pipe is put in or this old pipe stays here, the water is still dumping into that location. Regardless, I understand that. So my concern would be we just have to get the proper easement, you know, through the property to get that. And then the second issue of later on, I will have to address that.
So is the city's promise to work with you satisfactory, that you believe that they in fact will work with you to address your needs and in exchange to move forward with this part of the project now?
I sure hope. I have sold land to the city for conservation, and it was quite the hassle before, and I've almost got a few discrepancies with them over that. So I don't always go by word of what the city goes by. No, I do not. If I had something officially in writing, I would feel more comfortable.
We can certainly look into that, providing you that. I guess one of my questions to the commission is the existence of an easement or lack thereof an obstruction to your review of our application?
No.
Is there any reason that we can't continue doing the application as presented and try to address any of your comments with respect?
Right. Understanding that you may be prevented from moving forward not by absence of approval by us, but by other issues that involve the landowner. Understood.
Exactly. I'm just trying to keep those two separate issues. Yeah.
How about that issue though of DEP and Sarah on a site visit agrees needing to pull back or advising that the outfall should be pulled back so that it's not directly in the resource area? I heard you say earlier you didn't think that would be functional if you were to do that.
I'm sorry, were you addressing me?
Yes.
We feel that it is not appropriate to do that because it's going to create a further issue. It's going to recreate the issue that's currently there, except it's going to move further up into Mr. Vollinger's field, which we think is not a good idea. I mean, it's
exactly. And again, just to chime in on that, if you were to change the print now and not leave it at its discharge location now and reduce, and if you're going to shrink it back into my field and take more pipe off, I would deny it totally. And I'm going to lose more that way. So I would back up on that and not even approve it right now.
So, and, Sarah, my understanding from the DEP is that that's not optional. We cannot say, yeah, sure, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, the issue here is the permanent proposed impacts to land underwater, right. Which just, there's no way to permit that. I don't know if maybe just changing the design, but not the location of the pipe would be possible. And I don't really know what the options would be for dealing with that.
So are you allowed to provide a discharge up to the limit of BVW? And I mean, doesn't seem to be any clear indication or guidance about how far offset be from the BVW. I mean, if we move the pipe back.
Yeah, as long as it's set back from it just a little bit, that would remove that waters of the United States trigger that.
I mean, what are we
necessitate all sorts of other permits.
Are we talking 6 inches? We can certainly accommodate that.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be fine.
Where the existing pipe is, the length of the existing pipe now, you would just be shortening the length of the pipe where it discharges now by 6 inches, correct?
Is that accurate? I wasn't clearly following the exchange between David and Sarah. So, is
it? Yeah, that would be. But of course, they would still have to put the riprap end and at the end of the pipe to prevent the scouring.
So right now, currently, that pipe sticks out of the ground and sticks out probably 8 to 10 inches already. So by cutting it back 6 inches is really just bringing it back to the head wall that they would be installing anyways. So in my opinion, that's not shortening that is not really going to affect the side of my field that big of a deal. If you were to shorten it 8 to 10 feet or something, that would be a dramatic thing to the side, to my field.
I want to be able to meet the intent of what the user inches is sufficient to do that, then I think we can accommodate that without a problem and without compromising Mr. Vollinger's field any further.
And Sarah, that you think that'll actually be pass muster with DEP?
Yeah, I think it will. It's the water quality certification,
right.
Waters of the United States discharge issue that they're concerned with. So as long as that direct alteration is eliminated, that shouldn't be an issue.
All right. So let's see if I'm absorbing all of this and see where we've gotten to that. With that small modification, the commission could permit the work as planned, and that and whether DPW actually can proceed with the work would depend on your negotiations with the landowner. But from our perspective, the work can be permitted as planned. Is that fair to say, Sarah, from the discussion so far?
Yeah, I think that's a good summary. I mean, ideally from a wetlands perspective, the whole stream would be daylighted and it would flow across the land, but that's not a good option for anybody in this case.
Any other input or thoughts from other commissioners before? It seems like maybe we can close the hearing knowing that the work may not get done depending on what happens after our approval, but.
Just before we close, there is another segment of the project. Pardon me? This is just the first piece.
I didn't hear all of that, Sarah.
There is another segment of the project. So this was a two-part project that we haven't discussed yet.
Ah.
Yeah, there's a section up near
right.
Old country way there. Plus the old path that used to go to Fitzgerald Lake. They're going to put a culvert under there.
Under there, right. Bob Zimmerman was on for a while. I don't see his screen anymore. But, I imagine that's the part that's of most interest to him.
Okay. Well,
Joanna, you or David want to summarize that other part that goes the culvert into Fitzgerald Lake area?
Certainly, I'd be happy to. So this part of the project proposes there's currently a drain pipe that collects drainage from the lower part of Country Way, part of North Farms Road. It runs through a pipe for about 300 feet and discharges directly to Broad Brook. The pipe is only 15 inches in diameter, and it's undersized, which means that it drainage tends to back up on the road and flood part of the road. A larger pipe isn't really possible given the existing utilities that are within the roadway. So we're proposing to instead move the discharge, create an outfall opposite the end of Country Way, and install a 24-inch pipe that would discharge towards that forested wetland. on the east side of North Farms Road. So the outfall would be within DBW buffer. And we're proposing, again, a stone pipe end at the end of the outfall. Also proposing a 30-foot channel which would all be within BBW buffer, so that the water would be directed away from the roadway. The channel will be planted with wetland plants, and we'd install a few boulders to sort of slow down the water a bit. Because this would be an increase in water heading towards this wetland area, the wetland area currently drains through a pipe under the pedestrian path. Mm-hmm. It's about a 15-inch pipe, which is partially buried. So it doesn't really have much flow capacity. So in order to handle the additional water that we're sending to this wetland, we're proposing to replace that pipe with a three-sided box culvert that's 4 feet wide, mm-hmm. 12 feet long, so that it completely extends underneath the path. That box culvert would have more flow capacity than what would be coming out of the new outfall. So this would be an improvement in terms of connecting hydrology on the site. Should be an improvement for wildlife passage.
Does it meet the new wetlands crossing standards?
It's as a wetland crossing, yes, it does. And that is, we're viewing it as a wetland crossing.
Yeah.
It's not strict, it doesn't meet the criteria to be considered a stream crossing, but this larger box culvert is clearly an improvement over the sunken pipe that's there currently.
Right. It's definitely, though, an improvement as far as passage of any wildlife through that area that use the culvert.
Hopefully the turtles and salamanders will think so.
Yeah.
We're actually considering upsizing it to a 5-foot culvert, which would in fact meet the stream crossing standards. So that's under consideration right now.
Okay. Other questions, comments from commissioners?
No, I have no problems with this section.
All right, so now motion to close the hearing. And Sarah, you just disappeared. There you are. Okay.
Trying to save my bandwidth. I'll come back as necessary.
Well, probably with practice, we'll get better at this way of doing meetings. So motion to close the hearing, and then we'll see if we can summarize what we've agreed to. Someone want to make that motion?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Excuse me.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So, as I started to say before, it seems like with that modification of a slight pullback of the outfall from the edge of the resource area, that we can approve the order of conditions, acknowledging that the DPW will still need to work with the landowner to resolve those issues about the easement in order to proceed with that portion of the work. But any other thoughts or conditions from commissioners that you want to attach to this?
No, I agree.
All right, so motion to that effect. Jason, you want to do that?
Excuse me.
And a second?
Yeah, I'll second.
Just checking on the staff recommendations.
Yes. So we have a motion and a second. Further discussion at this point? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
So voted. Good luck. I'm actually thinking I'll still take a trip out there and see if I can get my own visual sense of this, even though we're not going to rule out again. I'm generally familiar with the area. I've been there many, many times, but just don't have all of these particular intersections clear in my head. So,
wear boots.
Anything else on this case before we move on? Oh, no, we got to get to Sarah's authorization to we allow her to sign these three items that we've agreed to in this meeting. How should we phrase that, Sarah?
I think basically just what's on the agenda. So authorize staff to sign permits voted on by the commission during the state of emergency.
Okay. So to clarify that when the commission has met virtually and issued a permit, that instead of us each needing to append our signatures, we authorize Sarah to sign on our behalf.
Does this pass legal muster?
It's kind of an unknown at this point. People are trying to work through it. One way to deal with it would be to have electronic signatures. I'm not quite sure how to do that. The orders of conditions are actually filed with DEP electronically. So I'm already doing that there. So this is really just for the Registry of Deeds.
Well, let's assume that we'll pass muster and somebody will.
It should be okay. I hope so.
All right.
So just one thought, Sarah, one extra step that might not be too hard would be for all of us to, for you to send out an email for us to hit reply authorizing. The email signatures do work in many instances. For example, in a court filing, a court will accept an email signature. So hitting reply rather than just a verbal.
Okay.
For example, you don't know who's still kind of paying attention on, you know, who's still sitting here, who's still paying attention. So hitting reply firms it up a bit.
Okay. I can send out an email tomorrow or early next week.
So how about we do it both ways so that there can actually be a record of a motion made and seconded and a vote taken and then an affirmation subsequently via email.
Sounds good.
Yeah. So Elizabeth, you want to make that as a motion?
So moved.
Okay, and a second.
Seconded.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So voted. All right. Sarah, anything else? Any permits that we need to review?
That's all for me. Things have been a little crazy. So we are not meeting on April 9th because that is Passover. I don't know if it would matter since we're meeting presumably remotely, but we don't have anything scheduled at this point. We will definitely meet on April 23rd. I will be able to get things out to you for that meeting very quickly. Those are already in place. And I do have remote access for the most part now.
We'll assume.
And some site visits would probably be helpful, but maybe we should not do that at the same time.
I think Kevin's trying to say something, but I think we've lost him.
Yeah, sort of like sound bites.
Yeah. Looks like he fell asleep.
Oh, yeah, his picture's gone, too.
Hey, are we all set? Motion to adjourn?
I move to adjourn.
Seconded.
Second.
Oh, there he is.
All right. Thank you, everybody.